Good morning, and delighted to be back in Romania for the fourth time. The weather before has never been this hot, so I'm suffering quite a lot with this, and I've been asked to talk about Romania's profile as an international development donor. The first time I came to Romania was in 2008, so I've been keeping an eye on Romanian development cooperation in that time. I hope Simon Maxwell won't mind me borrowing a phrase that he used. He organises events every now and again where you meet the people from DFID's EU department and NGOs, and he calls it the Friends of EU DFID, I think. And I'd like to put that down as I would regard myself as a friend of Romanian development cooperation. So what I say needs to be taken into that context. My friend and colleague Balázs, his name's on here because this is to some extent the reflections of work that I've been doing with him. And in a shameless piece of self-publicity, these are the two books that are out now. Oh, it's gone back again, isn't it? PowerPoint problem. So the first one, we've been looking mainly at the Visegrad states, but this book here with my friend Andre, who's sitting at the front, takes a perspective across all of the EU-12. Unfortunately, we didn't do Croatia. We apologise for that, but the nature of things. So this is an overview of our research, but what I would like to start with is an image. This interesting book by an American academic, Van der Veen, talks about aid as a Swiss Army knife. You can use it in a variety of different ways. And one of the interesting things about aid is how you use it and how you keep using it. So if you use aid in a particular manner, you can see what that tells you about its links to foreign policy. So if you only use your Swiss Army knife as a bottle opener, that tells you how you see your Swiss Army knife. If you use it for the variety of tasks, that tells you something about it too. So I'd like you to keep that image of the Swiss Army knife in your mind as we move on to look at basically what we're trying to understand is the groups and where Romania fits in within these groups. We got very concerned about the terminology. We settled on East Central Europe for the region. But I think when you're talking about the different donors, there are very clearly four groups now. You've got DAC members, you've got OECD non-DAC members, EU members since 2007. And obviously what we're trying to think about is what are the comparators? Is it worth comparing Latvia with Romania just because they joined the EU at the same similar time? Is it worth comparing the Czech Republic with Austria because they have a similar policy? So one of the things that I think it'd be important for future research is to see which donors are the ones that are best comparators to the different countries. And what I'm going to offer is some reflections on how Romania might position itself and compare itself against some of these donors. And again, we're also interested in the role played by the different international organizations. I thought I'd start with this graphic because it was very visible yesterday in terms of the commitments on aid spending and ODA. And as with all PowerPoints, they work brilliantly on your laptop until you then get them in front of an audience and no one can read them. So this is basically showing that there's Romania is in this column, four down from the top. So it's talking about the amount of aid it's given. You take the next slide, which is then its contribution as a percentage of GNI. And unfortunately, Romania comes right the way across towards the bottom. But actually, I think the picture is much more complicated than that, and it's much more nuanced than just looking at the money. And what I thought it would be useful, following on from Simon's presentation yesterday, was just to give you a sense of some of the issues in the UK. We undertook a public opinion survey just before the election, looking at what people in Britain thought aid should be used for. And as you can see, there's a raft of different opinions. A large number of people think aid should just be used for national self-interest, and a large number of people think it should be used to tackle need, poverty, etc. So it's important to bear this in mind, that a long established donor with an interesting history, I think is probably the best way that I can deal with some of the histories of Britain as a global player, there are still divisions. And one other thing that I thought would be interesting is to say it is important to get development on the agenda and on the agenda of the media and raise public opinion, but you do have to be a little bit careful because you have to be able to deal with the consequences. The UK government, its commitment to 0.7, produced these types of headlines in a very popular, as in it's got a large readership, newspaper in the United Kingdom. When you have your aid policy so visible, it then becomes a legitimate subject for scrutiny, and you start to read. I mean, there's hundreds of these if you go onto Google and you get a sense of the aid debate. So I thought I'd use that as a beginning just to frame the fact that all donors are struggling with this. There's a famous definition of politics it's all about who gets what, how, and when. And I really like that because it starts to make you think about politics as a cake. There is a cake. There's not an infinite resource. It's about how you distribute that cake. And if you make a decision in one way, then you're going to have a consequence somewhere else. So the Daily Mail, I thought the main headline I wanted to bring your attention to was "Put UK Flood Victims First." Spend the aid money in the UK. So these are the different debates. You've got all of these things going on. And aid is a complicated business. Academic, bit of a table. These are the things. These are the different actors involved. These are the relationships. These are the pressures to get this foreign aid policy outcome. And I think it's worth bearing this in mind because some of the things that I'm going to say are about relationships between NGOs and ministries, about relationships between Parliament and the ministries, how you involve the public, what role do different actors play to try and come out with the right, in inverted commas, foreign policy instruments. So I have taken a little bit of a coward's way out, and what I'm doing is presenting what we've identified as 10 of the global norms. Again, this was written a few years ago, and these noble norms are going to be reviewed, and Anna mentioned, I think, some of these in her presentation. But what you want to be thinking about is, to what extent does Romania get close to these types of global checklists? To what extent has it got a plan to get, there are 10, so there's another slide. So in terms of increasing share of bilateral aid, reducing tide aid, increasing budget support, so it's not just about absolutely increasing the amount of ODA, it's about doing things smarter with aid, thinking about issues such as multi-annual programming, understanding how these decisions arrived at, realistic number of partner countries, focusing on different sectors, country systems to shore alignment. So these sort of checklists are crucial because that would be the global consensus. The global consensus may be evolving, but these also link very closely to the EU acquis on the topic. So as the experts in the room, you can run that checklist and you can see to what extent you think that Romania comes up to those. And again, I would just reiterate the fact that, moving on, that Romania is clearly positioned in a very strategically important part of the world. It clearly has a value added in this part of the world. And then to just think about what has been achieved. When I first came to Romania, my child, Ben, was 2. He's now 8. And most of what he is doing at school is putting the foundations down for him to build on as he goes through his life. And so if you think about that, I came to Romania 1 year after you became part of the European Union. Whether you want to say you're a donor at one, I'm not sure I want to get into those debates, but the idea is that you take that analogy of age and look back and say, actually, what needs to be happening at this point is making sure you have the solid foundations. And this document, to me, suggests that there are lots of solid foundations being put down. And I think there's a lot to praise and there's a lot to suggest is important. I think one of the things that we've identified, and this is not just about Romania, is the transition experience narrative is a very strong narrative, but it needs to have flesh put on it. What does that mean in practice? How translatable is this transition experience? Show me the money, the famous line from the film Jerry Maguire. So it's not just about the overall amount, it's about what you're doing with the money, where it's being targeted, those types of actions. It's about getting the expertise. That's the constant. If you look through the Aid Watch reports, the constant thing is about capacity within the MFA. Since I've been looking at Romania, I think they're now on the 4th head of unit within the development directorate within the MFA. So you need to get that sense of continuity, but also not just in Bucharest, but in Brussels. Getting your voice heard. Romania is the 7th largest EU state, and it should be able to influence more at the European level around this topic. And I think that's something that needs to be considered when it comes to issues related to personnel. Public opinion, as Simon was saying yesterday, appears to be ready for greater development cooperation, but that needs to be managed carefully, as does the role of, or the relationship between FOND and the MFA. Our research showed that being too critical of the MFA can often be counterproductive, because that can be used by the opponents of the MFA within that complicated model that I was showing you. So you can find common cause around development with actors within the MFA, but clearly you've also got to be careful about coming too close. How do you make it relevant to MPs, political elites, the private sector? So again, this type of narrative around this is important. And again, it's important to consider the fact that DFID was only created in its current form in 1997, which to me was only yesterday. It's now historic. But again, it's important to consider these types of changes over time. And I got asked to do the crystal ball gazing thing where you look into the future. And I think perhaps that Romania, its size, it is aiming, it should be aiming for a middle power, the soft power type of influence, and its aid policy should reflect that. I was trying not to end on a slightly negative, but you know, looking at that map, you realize that this is the thinking in Ankara. You look at what Turkey is doing with its aid policy, and it may not be looking so much to the West, but it is trying to identify itself as a middle power in the region, and therefore the market for that type of opportunity for Romania may be starting to becoming limited by that. So that is something that's very important. But again, I think what I would suggest is a realistic reading again of this to see how things have changed over the time, but also a realistic sense of the fact that we are only talking about a relatively short period of time And therefore, you need to keep that sense of perspective, but looking to build the foundations for the future. And as is obligatory, happy to answer any questions later on. Thank you.